with chumps and toll and telegrams and all exchanges too. Just telephone and we will pull you through.
Ring every corner archway.
These days now are awesome.
Ring anywhere, we're waiting on your phone.
The 1930s saw a rapid expansion of the telephone network. What had been the toy of rich Edwardians had become the tool of commerce and of the common man. Despite the success of the system, the post office still did not have a completely satisfactory public kiosk. Scott was asked for a new design. He produced the K3, cast in concrete for cheapness. It was a modified version of the K2. The design was satisfactory, but the quality of the concrete was not. It cracked. Despite this, there were once 12,000 K3s all over Britain. Today, only a handful remain, one of them tucked away in a disused corner of London Zoo. Another kiosk appeared, the K4, an ambitious combination of phone kiosk, stamp vending machine and postbox. This survivor is at Warrington in Lancashire. But the stamp machine made too much noise, disrupting calls, and the stamps got stuck in damp weather. Only 50 were produced. In May 1935, King George V, Queen Mary, and the nation celebrated the King's Silver Jubilee. There were celebrations everywhere. The post office, not to be outdone, announced that it would greatly extend its public phone service. A telephone would be provided in every village and town on the mainland, which already had a post office. To house them, a new kiosk was commissioned, again from Sir Giles Gilbert Scott. The result was the K6, or Jubilee Kiosk as it was to be called. The new kiosk was at last everything that was wanted. It was functional, elegant, and with its simplified mouldings and decoration, cheap to mass produce. The essential features of the K2 remain, including the Sonian dome. The most apparent change was in the fenestration. The Georgian glazing gave way to a contemporary modern. The K6 was still large, weighing 1,300 weights and standing over 8 feet high. The crown was now embossed, not pierced, with a narrow ventilation slit beneath the sign. There were new internal fittings too, not designed by Scott, but by the GPO. Bakelite and chrome, a beveled mirror, redesigned buttons A and B, even an umbrella hook. The post office could justly boast that the new kiosk left little to be desired. This was to be the first genuinely standard kiosk in town and country. These home movies give a very different impression of Sir Giles Gilbert Scott, who in his professional capacity was serious and retiring, a man passionately devoted to architecture. By the mid-1930s, every honour had been heaped on him. By then, he had a remarkable series of buildings to his credit, including the external detailing of the new Battersea Power Station. The later Waterloo Bridge was Scott's too. He tried to combine the best of traditional work with the new technological demands of his time, and to come to terms with the progressive modernism which was making itself felt. Yet the modernist hated his kiosk. Scott found it attacked on two fronts.
Modern design people, modern architects, looked at it and were pretty appalled. I mean, they thought it was regressive, they thought it was fairly backward, they thought the classical style was inappropriate to a modern amenity. But the second response, that was again highly critical, came from within the branches of the Council for the Preservation of Rural England and organisations of this kind. What people objected to was that the telephone box stood out, and it wasn't designed apparently to blend in with grey stone, etc. And there was a hard-fought battle. I mean, that the post office actually found itself defending the colour, but the principal argument that they made was that if we get into camouflaging every modern amenity, we will end up thatching motor coaches. There will be nothing that goes into the country that isn't sort of faked out.
An internal post office memo of 1936 noted that people began fulminating against an unfamiliar sight, but they are rapidly passing through tolerance towards admiration. And admiration there was, as the Jubilee kiosk settled down for more than 30 years as an integral part of the British scene. More than 60,000 K6s were produced, This, the smallest design by Gilbert Scott, was also his most familiar. It was a part of everyone's experience.
50 years ago, and more now, you might, if you were alive, see the first red Jubilee box, invented 1935. Ready for the cries of wartime, news of love, or leave, or loss. Messenger unmoved, unmoving, where the coins were like a toss, turning up with joy or sorrow, happy heads or tearful tails, getting into bed with beauty, stretched out on a bed of nails. Peacetime problems some years later. Who would answer when you rang? Disapproving mother, husband, brother, that orangutan? Lonely valley, one shop village, pullulating city square. When you needed it, it stood there, waiting. It was always there. Like a pillar box, official, Chelsea pensioner, red bus. It gave colour to our landscape. Landline, lifeline, there for us.
Mid-December, in the small Nottinghamshire village of Kersal, Mrs. Brenda Wood arrives to decorate the village Jubilee kiosk for Christmas.
If we have any special events during the year, say we have the royal birth or it's the Queen's birthday or something like that, I usually trim it up with silver leaves and red and white flowers, perhaps a Union Jack or something. When it was Princess Beatrice's, when she arrived, I trimmed it all up with little pink posies and pink ribbons and put a photograph of Fergie and Andrew in there. People came to see it. They enjoyed it. We always have a nice card in there and we always have a bunch of flowers, usually wildflowers if we can get them, if it's the right time of the year, anything appropriate to the season. The box, to me, it's part of the countryside. When you go around the little villages and you see the red telephone boxes, it would give you a sense of security. It stands for England.
But I was brought up with the K6 as just being ordinary. I mean, the tragedy of what has happened is something that one took for granted has suddenly been removed, and it's taken people some time to realise what we've lost. Had they been replaced when they were worn out, I would have accepted that quite happily, and had they been replaced by a good new design, I would have been quite happy. In fact, of course, they've all been removed in this sort of simultaneous holocaust of some 60,000 kiosks, entirely because, not of nostalgia, because of its reverse, an equally absurd thing, an obsession with modernity.
A gradual replacement of the Scott kiosk had started in 1968, when these appeared, K8s, designed primarily for new towns and to resist vandalism. Now they too are all to be scrapped. The designer of the K8 was Bruce Martin.
We had a very good brief from the post office. We thought, well, let's see how Gilbert Scott's kiosk stands up to this brief. After all, we can't, on the face of it, see much wrong with the Gilbert Scott kiosk. In fact, we began to wonder why they were asking to design a new one anyway. And when we checked Gilbert Scott's kiosk against the new brief, we found that he only failed on two points. One was that it was very difficult to clean, and this was mainly due to the 54 pieces, small pieces of glass, and because the mouldings were difficult to clean, which is a consequence of his classical design. And he also failed on the fact it wasn't very well ventilated. He hadn't really thought about ventilation, we think. And that was about it.
But unfortunately, that was not all that was wrong with them. Scott's kiosks had fallen foul of unpleasant changes in British society. They were a mecca for vandals, were used as urinals, were smelly, and were now seen as expensive to maintain and to clean. It was difficult to open the heavy teak door, and with each side identical, it was often hard to get out. But perhaps the kiosk had suffered in public esteem because it was made to house an often faulty product.
Norwich.
There is no modern equivalent of the Jubilee kiosk. Standardization has been replaced by diversification. For BT, and now Mercury, the emphasis is on image rather than on design. But design considerations there are. No door means no smell, even if it is difficult to actually hear. The finishes do not need painting and are easy to clean. The openness is intended to make people feel vulnerable, to deter the vandal. And the disabled can use them too.
There are others which are in the areas where the new underclass live, I mean the inner city or the ghettos or whatever you want to call them, which are basically pre-vandalised. I mean there's nothing left to kick off them, there's nothing left to steal, there's nothing left to break. It's all been done before the thing was installed. You're talking about a metal stump with a kind of armoured card phone bolted onto it. And there's no doubt that one can't blame British Telecom for the changes in society that have produced that sort of polarisation. But it's not surprising that the old red telephone box becomes a kind of nostalgic emblem when people have seen those developments happen in the last 30 or 40 years.
Although some of Scott's kiosks still make a tenacious stand in villages, they will only survive in the cities where they've been listed and preserved. Despite being as functional as ever, they're in danger of becoming ancient monuments, part of the heritage industry. What was once ordinary and excellent, a well-designed piece of street furniture, could start to look fake. With the advent of personal portable phones, most public kiosks could be redundant. However, a few of Scott's kiosks are assured a place in the 21st century. A nostalgic reminder of a less pressured age, but nonetheless beacons of good design. Design made available to everyone.
Put a nickel in the telephone, dial my baby's number, got a busy line. Each time I tried, I got a busy tone, not my baby's number, just a busy line. Called his uncle in Jamaica, left a message with the baker, even checked the number in the telephone book. Got so awfully, awfully worried, to my baby's house I hurried. When I looked inside, the phone was off the hook. And as I walked up to my baby then, I got my baby's number. He was busy in the parlor doing fine. Busy kissing someone else, all I was keeping busy, getting a busy line. Busy life. Busy life. Thank you.